Can I get your name, sir?
Jerry Enko, producer.
Producer of?
Slaughterhouse, baby.
This film right here?
Right.
I'm sorry, these seats are reserved, sir.
Oh, they're reserved?
Yeah.
Oh.
Sally Gina Park just down the road making out. We could sneak up on him.
I got
tickets. But doggone it, now I'm on the other side of the fence. I got a wife and a couple of little screamers, and I'd like to see them enjoy life in one piece and not end up splattered all over the front end of your Jeep.
Piece of cutlery that he ran around with, minus the hoof that was on it, but we lost the hoof somewhere along the line. I'd like to introduce the producer of Slaughterhouse, who's in the audience, Jerry Enko, my longtime friend, filmmaker. To introduce Mike Scaglione, all the set pieces, all the props. Yep, and Dean Andelsek, who was lighting and all that rain at the end. Dean was pumping that water. Okay, now for the stars. Sherry Bendorf, please. She looked us up 3 years ago. And Courtney Lorcara. Now, everybody loved Deputy Dave. Jeff Wright. Am I missing anybody? There's a lot of Slaughterhouse people here. Are you? Oh, no. Well, again, we open it up for question and answers, and Jerry has all of the information as to the budget, if you're interested in that. Everybody, you know, obviously our prop guy did a spectacular job. We actually used for the main site, the exterior, was a food processing or a vegetable processing plant that was closed down. And we were very lucky to find it. Jerry found it one day roaming around near the Tijuana border. And then the other interiors, to make it look like one slaughtering plant, we had to use three other sites. So the place where the auger was that chewed up the guy was one site. The place where he slid the, or he took the hand off Jeff and slid the door open, there's that big ice bridge there. That was a separate plant. And then whenever they were walking and running around amongst the wooden frame areas, the staircases and things like that, that was another plant. So it all tied together. And of course the exterior looked a little bit small for to have all those big, huge rooms in it. So we put the line in there. How about those underground coolers? So they go down, they never come up.
So before we have a question, we'll start with you and Jerry, sort of the background of this, because for the two of you, this was your first feature film for the both of you?
Yes.
And this is 1987, it's going to come out, so we're talking a little bit later in the slasher period, kind of, yeah, in the period when slasher films and films of this were kind of moving from theatrical releases going towards the direct-to-video type thing. So where did the idea for this come up? And I mean, I can see some influences in here, I mean, that may or may not be there, obviously, but where did you guys come up with this and decide to get into feature filmmaking and to, you know, get in an independent horror film?
Let me start. Rick and I both worked for the Navy in San Diego, and we did training films. And we got a little tired of doing that, so one day we talked about making a feature film, and actually it was kind of born from that. Rick came up with the script, and probably the hardest part was raising the money, because we're essentially unknown people, and we raised initially $110,000 from family and friends, so we're really on the hook to them to get their money back. And anyway, and Rick can talk about how he got the story.
Well, I just wondered what to start out with, and of course horror is the best break-in genre there is. You can't do comedy very successfully without great comedians. So, but I kind of like comedy, so I wove that in all through this thing as best I could. And I don't know, I just picked the slaughtering plant as a good place to start, and it developed from there. And we needed a character, of course. And I think finding the right character, Buddy, Joe Barton, was the hardest part of the whole thing. We have some lovely ladies down here. That was the easiest part. There's a lot of lovely ladies out there, but you were special, that's for sure. And look, yes,
keep
sorry?
Keep going. No,
I just wanted to have the ladies come over. Do you have a mic down there?
There's three mics spread out.
Oh, okay. Jerry, you'd like to say a few words on the acting?
I feel like I should start with a screen. About the acting, like,
well, how we found you, what your background is.
We talked about this. I had just moved out from Iowa. I'm one of those people that came from the country to Hollywood to find stardom, I guess. But really came out just because I wanted to work in the business, didn't really know what I wanted to do. And how many of you guys have been here since like the 80s? Do you remember the Dronalogue?
Yeah.
Thank you. That's where all of us beginners got our work, and I self-submitted through the Dronalogue all the time, and actually still kept, once I got the call for the audition for this, I tore the page, this is how anal I was, I tore the page out of the Dronalogue, because I thought, this might be really cool for my scrapbook someday, so it's all highlighted, and Rick got a kick out of that when I signed back in December. So I submitted for it, and I think I had just gotten my voicemail, or my voice machine, from the little cassette tapes and stuff that they had on me at answering machines. Because I thought everybody was cool that had it. So I had gone to the audition and came back and had a voicemail, red lights blinking, and I'm thinking, oh, it's mom. So I got the call from Rick, and they said that they wanted me to come in and to audition. And when I was, you know, I was thrilled, and so I went in, and actually I think that was afterwards, because I went into the audition and then came home, and that's when the machine was blinking, and it said, "Hey, this is Rick. I actually first read for Sally Jean, and which was his girlfriend, and the message said, "Hey, thanks for coming in. We think we miscast you," and my heart just sank. And said, "We really don't want you for the part of Sally Jean. We'd like you for the part of Liz." And I was like, "Oh my God, playback, rewind, playback," I was just so thrilled to hear that. And so, that was kind of the start of it. And then did a screen test with Eric at Panavision. I'm dating myself, but we know it's 30 years old. So that was my start at it. So
I'm Courtney. I'm the one killed off before the opening. My family gave me a lot of grief for that. You finally get in a film and you're killed before like the opening. So the same thing, found it in Dramalog and auditioned, was very excited to get the part. And then after doing this, I actually started to get kind of pegged doing horror films. So I went on to do a Night Ripper, Killing Spree, The Feast, Thing in the Box, and just one horror film after another. But it was a great film and a lot of fun to do, and I can't believe it was 30 years ago.
I know.
But you appear throughout the movie.
I do.
Yeah, she was just hanging around. I'm sorry. The toughest part was casting Buddy, as you can imagine. You need a certain huge person. You needed a guy with a special face, and we were really in deep trouble there because the people we had checked just didn't fit the bill for us. And one day when we were down, I think it was Highland, and we were casting, and we took a break, went out on the corner and just got out of the casting area. And I was standing there, and up comes this fellow, Joe B. Barton, and he stood about this tall. And I looked at him, and he said, "Are you casting for Slaughterhouse? I understand you're the guy, the director." And I said, "Yes." And I looked at him, and I went, "This is the guy." I mean, I looked in that face. He was wearing a chain around his neck. He was wearing his Farmer John's. He'd come ready for that part. And I thought, "Oh my gosh, but how about the size, We need a huge oaf." Well, that's the magic of film. We put him on pallets. We built ramps, so when he came up behind Bill Brinsfield and lowered him into the auger, that was a ramp. He walked up and all of a sudden loomed over Bill, who was taller than me. And that's how we got Bud.
I was surprised. I haven't seen the film. I never would have guessed. Mike mentioned before the film that, he was just about this size. I had no idea. And some of you may have seen him also, over the years, a couple times we've shown Blood Diner. He has a bit part in Blood Diner as a biker. Before that. So even I don't need to watch Blood Diner, he's in that also.
Another quick thing about Buddy. He was born and raised on a hog farm in Missouri, of all places. What a perfect guy. Not only did he look the part, but he had the background to handle the hogs. And he was our hog wrangler. So whenever you saw hogs in a scene, even if he wasn't there, he was wrangling them. He's tossing them in there, as well as Skag here. And that's how we got things done. And so when we were out doing the pig pen routine with a cat, we said, "Buddy, what we'll do is we'll put some cardboard down for you and put a little fresh hay on it, and you can plop down in there so you won't be in all the feces and urine and everything that was in the pen." And he said, "Oh, no." Boom, he goes right on down. he grabs the hogs and he starts doing this. And we were using an Aeroflex 2C, no sound. We don't need the sound of it in later. And we shot as quickly as we could. Poor Buddy's getting saturated down there.
And I don't know, it's too. Now, you had a limited theatrical release. You guys had your own releasing company that is self-releasing this, but it was a very limited release. So were you guys planning to do a limited release followed by a video, or what were the plans for the film when you made the film? And I know you had some problems with the release and getting paid.
Well, we did a theatrical release in accordance with the home video deal that we did. I think we had 35 prints, and we released it in, was it 9 different cities?
Yeah.
Something like that. And after that, it went directly to video after that, so.
You guys kind of straddled that period as it was switching over from theatrical to kind of home video.
Yeah, and one of the things, we wanted to keep making films, but it took so long to get our money back, and it took so long for us to make the film that, and we both had young kids at the time, and we had jobs with the Navy, and so anyway, we got kind of burned out, but we still wish we would have made a sequel to Slaughterhouse, for sure.
Yeah, we had a script, actually.
this was it for a theatrical feature for the two of you. I know some of you have done on, like Sherry, I know you've done a lot of acting and stunt stuff, but this was, just you guys came out and made one film and then went back to work.
Right. We've all worked at some point in other times on either theatrical films or documentaries, whatever, but yeah, this was the one that we produced. That was it. Like one hit wonder.
Let's take some questions from the audience, too. I'm sure some of you have seen this for the first time, that also. So let's take a few questions from the audience, please, guys. Don't be shy. It's right there.
Yes, sir.
So it's very briefly mentioned in the movie that Buddy had a younger brother, and it doesn't say what happened to him. Was that the setup for the sequel?
Absolutely. Thank you very much. Very astute. We didn't mention his name, which is Maggot. Very good. Yes, sir.
How did you settle on Vantage Point to do the score?
One of our investors, who happens to be in the audience tonight, had a young man who worked for him, who I believe was in Vantage Point. Is that correct, Ed? Eddie?
In what?
The band, Vantage Point. Did he work for you?
No, he was the connection, yes.
Yeah, so that's kind of the connection.
I'd like to mention one thing, Mike. Mike was the one that had to round up all the dead beasts that you saw in there. And I'd like you to mention how you went about that. They're actual dead carcasses.
We needed a bunch of them, but the budget didn't warrant getting them made, nor the time frame to get them done. So I discovered a hog farm out in East San Diego County and went and dug up real live dead pigs. I had eight giant garbage bags full of dead pigs in the back of my 61 Falcon station wagon. And was simultaneously hoping the cops would pull me over and wouldn't kill me. But it's an almost, I'm sure the health department would not allow us to do that anymore. But all those swine shrines and all the dead pigs and all that was all real stuff. But they had been mummified by the time they were dug up, so they weren't stinky or dirty, and everybody was playing with them. And probably still has some.
No.
Take a look. Question.
Yes, sir.
How long did this take you guys to shoot? About how long did the production go on?
21 days initially. We shot 7 days a week, almost 24 hours a day. And we ran out of money and went to search for more money. Wound up shooting the ending over a 4-day weekend about 5 months later. As far as post-production, I'd say 6 months.
Yeah, the great editor, Sergio Uribe, who couldn't make it tonight, did it. We were lucky to get him.
I thought he was coming tonight.
No, actually he's here. We use a phony name. We use a lot of phony names.
There are a lot of other crew members here tonight, too.
Jerry and I edited it in my garage. But because Hollywood likes all these, European names and things like Laszlo Kovacs and things like that, we settled on a Hispanic name, Sergio Uribe.
IMDb is apparently 2 credits of that name, and they've confused somebody else from South America who now...
I see.
When the police officer's shooting at Buddy and it hits the weapon there, it looks like there's some animation.
There were sparks. You didn't see them very well in this projection of it, but yeah, just boom, real quick. You're right, and that was a post.
It was animation. It was post projection.
Yeah, several things were done in post. That, and of course, the lightning strikes. Yes, sir. Or back there. Yeah.
Oh, okay. With you guys, being from San Diego and working there and a lot of this shooting down there and, being thanked at the end, why go with, the L.A. County Sheriff's patch and everything? Why not just ride or die in San Diego and make that a part of the on-screen world as well?
I think we rented the costumes up here.
I think it's a very simple, cost-effective reason to
expand. Yeah, we did. We rented everything over here. Actually, we only had one patrol car, and you see him at one point at night walk from his patrol car, the sheriff does, to another patrol car. It's actually the same car we just moved in. So if you were to look at that sequence again, he walks away from his, around the car that had the smashed windshield, and then we cut judiciously because we moved our one car over into the other position. So that's how we got away with that.
We'll have time for a few more questions. If you ask a bad question, you have to face the axe.
Let's start with you. Look. The hand up, woman in the middle, Blake.
How did you pick Lakeside?
How did you pick Lakeside as your shooting range?
Lakeside was our hick town, our cowboy town. And it's you probably know where it is, but it's 25 minutes out of San Diego. As you head east on I-8, and it is our cowboy town of San Diego County. And they were real pleased to have us out there. We didn't get in any trouble. And the thing I used to cringe about is that we didn't require no police escort, nothing, when we're working in the streets, which was really nice. And so I was always cringing when we went through stop signs and all those things for the shots. But anything else?
Here we go. We'll get to the middle again.
Okay.
Buddy didn't have much dialogue, but I was curious who did the sound effects and stuff. Was that just like a voice actor, or was it samples? Or?
Do you want to do the sound effects?
Okay, it's Jerry and myself. Yeah. We not only edited under Sergio Uribe, but we also did all grunting in it. If you were to hear Buddy, like I said, he was fairly short. And he talked like this. He had a high-pitched voice. So the sweetest guy you ever want to work with. But, yeah, that didn't work. So Jerry and I took turns grunting in front of a microphone.
Do we have another? I
suppose
someone with a hand up.
Sure.
Yeah, the dude who played Buddy's dad, he was awesome. Like talk about him.
Oh, Don Barrett? Was great. There's just, again, we were so lucky to have great talent and people who really wanted to do this. That made it special. We all worked together well. And even though we had 18-hour days and short turnarounds and things like that, everybody, I think, had a pretty darn good time. And we fed them well. That was amazing. No white bread salami sandwiches for these guys.
We're probably going to have to wrap it up. So I'm going to take one more question. I'm going to take... not you with the hat, the guy behind you had his hand up first. Let me grab him.
I want to say I really enjoyed the part of Buddy's dad being almost like a connoisseur or craftsman about how the slaughterhouse, 30% fat, we're clogging our arteries. What part did that come in? Was that someone's, was that between you and the actor? Was that someone in real life took inspiration from?
I'm sorry, you spoiled this whole thing. I have something here that I was going to give out if anybody could answer that question. How much fat would he allow in this? I'm going to give you this because I bet you're a barbecue guy. Are you a barbecue guy?
Can I say something else?
Come on down here.
I want to say something else too. First of all, thank you guys so much for coming out here. This is huge for us for having it at 30 years. Amazing. They made, like you said, long days, short turnarounds. Just so comfortable. And the other actors that we worked with were so professional, and it was such a great overall experience. And we're really proud of how it turned out. And it's these guys that really did it together, and we're just applaud you and thank you.
One more thing.
I have a special delivery from you.
Okay. Okay, we'll check it out. Thank you very much. One more thing. I saw a lot of people cringing out there when your finger was sliced.
I stunt double.
Yeah. What we did is, you don't have a 30-person crew or actors standing around just for an extreme close-up. So we did that in my garage. We had my old elderly neighbor come from across the street. He put on Don Barrett's shirt. I sliced my fingertip. It was 30 years ago, so it was a young-looking fingertip. Sliced it with a razor blade, and then the old man drew it across, and we had an Aeroflex 2C with diopters on it, and we shot it with a couple quartz lamps going in there. So that was a cheap way of doing it. Got it done.
You really sliced your finger?
Yeah.
Okay, it's dedication.
Yes. This is a note from Price Waterhouse. The Academy Awards in 1987, they said they mixed up the cards and Slaughterhouse won the best picture.
I'm